Yeah, the mother of my son, Nicholas, 28 years ago, she died a little after Thanksgiving morning because of hyperthyroidism and endocrine disruptors. And I didn't really at the time, even though she was starting to follow a healthy diet, the doctors, did induce labor for 4 days, and it was very stressful on her. And at the time, she was having headaches and swelling, and they said, "Well, just take aspirin and go home." And at the time, I didn't understand what was going on with her thyroid condition. And of course, we know that there's a lot of endocrine disruptors and certain things that affect our thyroid. And so for me, I spent the last 28 years studying everything I could about hormonal balance and about diet and exercise and meditation and everything that it takes to help people live a better quality life. So, when my son, who never met his mother, we went up to Northern California, and I remember sharing with you that she had passed. And it was a tough time for me because, to raise my son, by myself, and to kind of live with that, that feeling of guilt that what could I have done to save her life? When you lose someone you love dearly, you got to dig deep and think, what more can I do to help people? So I'm so thankful that you're on the show today, Chef AJ and John McDougall, because, it's motivated me to help. And Chef AJ, you're doing like daily shows. You are amazing. And John, you're still coming out and doing shows. And I, again, it means the world to me that you're out there sharing the truth.
Today was my 450th show.
God bless. Yeah.
And I know you've been on, and Dr. McDougall's been on quite a bit. I'd have him on every day if he'd come.
Yeah, right. You get tired of me.
I wouldn't.
Anyway, there've been a lot of people involved in this, and it's been a successful thing for some people who would listen. Like you say, it always works. It's so fundamental. It's as fundamental as a drunk downing a bottle of vodka and the results. And if you sober the drunk up, you know what's going to happen. The same thing with food poisoning. You stop poisoning people, and the food poisons are very simple. They're animal foods and vegetable oils. And instead, you feed them a starch-based diet with fruits and vegetables. You walk them around a little bit, give them a little sunshine, take them off some of their toxic drugs, the ones that are doing them more harm than good. And they thrive. And even in older age, you say, "I'm still around, Nick." I've been doing this for half a century. I'm now in my mid-70s, and I have to say, I'm as good at speaking, maybe better, and as good at writing, and maybe better, and putting slideshows together. And I think it's because, as you age, what happens is some things coalesce, and they start to make a total sense. And I've forgotten a lot of facts. Some of them that you've brought up today that I've forgotten. But that's okay. I think what happens with getting older is you have such a broadening of your understanding of what's going on that you're able to convey the message much better. At least I've found that in myself. And I'm certainly hoping that over the next 10 years, I don't lose that. Certainly by 85, it would be not usual for people to be functioning as well as they did in their 40s. And it's very seldom at 95. I tell you, I have no particular long-term goals like that. I just, want to keep working.
Yeah, I tell the example of Bernardo LaPello, who grew up in the Phoenix, Arizona area, and he lived to the age of 114, 115, plus or minus there. And he wrote a book, author of Living Beyond 100, but his secret was he was mostly plant-based. He would walk every morning. He would get to sleep at sunset and rise. Sunset and then rise at sunrise. And he followed a whole plant-based diet for all those years. And there's videos of him making like a bean salad and a fresh fruit salad and a green vegetable salad. And he would add in garlic and different things. And, it's really exciting because my mom has turned 86, and she helped me with this book, Simply Healthy Cookbook, which took me 15 years of gathering recipes from around the world. And I know, Chef AJ, you have an incredible cookbook, and John with Mary and her ability to help with cookbooks. Because, I remember back when our lecturers, our educators, when they taught the science, but they weren't in the food preparation department. I look back and a lot of those guys gained the weight or, not too healthy now. But the food demonstrators, the cooks, they're all in great shape. They look fantastic because they learned
proper food preparation and to make it a way of life. Isn't that the most critical factor, Chef AJ and John, is to make this something that is just, you do it without thinking. You don't sacrifice. You wouldn't put cheap gasoline in a nice brand new car. You'd put the best gasoline. You wouldn't mix it with kerosene to cut it or something, or put fat in the gas tank. Do it the best. Horse race owners, they feed their horses better than anything. You wouldn't give horses the wrong food. So why are we doing this to our bodies? Because a lot of people, like Jack O'Lane, who ate foods as grown, he was very into, at age 95, trying to do the right thing. And Bob Del Matique, who I coached near the end of his life, and got him on a plant-based whole foods diet. Here's a picture of him at age 84. So, each person kind of comes into this life, and they sometimes look at us plant-based doctors and educators and they go, well, how come you're not big and muscular like some of these people? Well, it's not the plant animal foods that's got them big and muscular. The muscular part, they admit they're using steroids, they're using chemicals to get massive with weight training. And we know that probably bioidentical hormones might be safer, but herbs modify these foods. So what do we need to do to educate people that it's not be eating a big slab of meat that are going to grow muscle? Gorillas are muscular, right? Bonobos monkeys are muscular, and they're all plant-based. Our relatives, if we believe they're part of our lineage, or if we just go back to the Bible and say what we were told is appropriate for our way of living. What do you think?
Well, I wish I had the answer, Nick, as to how to get people to change. I think you have to be persistent. So if you have friends or relatives that you really care about and you get discouraged because of their negative reaction to you when you suggest a good diet, don't get discouraged. It takes multiple interactions with people. And, I've found, and I get asked quite often because I've taken care of over 12,000 people. I get asked, who is it that's going to make this kind of change? And I tell you the truth, I don't know. It could be a well-educated professor in chemistry who's been to school for, post-grad education and so on, refuses it. Whereas the person who's had, a fifth grade education and, no opportunities in life, they can see it. I don't know. I come to the conclusion it takes a little bit of knowledge, a little bit of ability to communicate, say an education of a seventh grader. That's enough. And you also need to have a high level of self-worth. Now, Nick, I think the biggest problem with people, and I don't know how to deal with that. I have a great psychologist, Doug Lyle, who tries to figure out how to deal with people's self-image. If people don't care about themselves, it's all downhill. These are the folks that smoke cigarettes still in face of all the knowledge we have, the ones that abuse alcohol with all the knowledge we have. They just don't care. As far as some people are concerned, it's just a matter of getting life over with. But you take a successful person who has a great family, great job, great life, and oh my goodness, just tell me how to be healthy. Tell me how to get my health. They're motivated. They care about themselves.
So I have a slide that I wanted to show, and that is this particular slide. It's possible that by getting as little as 20 to 25 grams of protein from plant protein only, no animal added whatsoever, the intestines slough off about 30 grams of protein, and it's pure quality protein that we redigest and recycle. We also recycle over 150 grams of enzymes that are the best quality protein the body has. So we already get over 180 grams of protein. Then if you just eat enough calories to meet your caloric needs, that is your ideal body weight, then you're going to get over 205 grams of protein without having to do these ridiculous athletic beliefs that you have to add 100 or 200 grams of more protein above. They're over toxic. They're getting too much sulfur. Is it the wrong kind of sulfur? Because plants have sulfur too. So which is it? I reviewed a recent talk of yours and you were talking about toxicity, how eggs stink, and you go to a lava pit and that's sulfur and that's toxin. But what about the plant sulfur? Because there's plant sulfur too. So what's going on with that?
I don't know that I have that completely figured out, Nick, and I don't know whether people have the biochemistry down enough to give me the answer that you're looking for. But I can tell you eating sulfur found in garlic and onions is a pleasurable experience for me. the rotten eggs, you know, the sulfur that comes from animal foods is disgusting. It sends a communication of sickness. Whereas I don't get that reaction when I eat high sulfur containing plant foods. There's a big difference. It's how they're packaged. It's how the sulfur is packaged, Nick.
Okay. And I also, is it true that the body recycles these essential intestines and enzymes? So we have a built-in way to kind of deal with what Frances Moore LePay, who you interviewed, and she talked about in Diet for a Small Planet, and I have that book on my shelf, that you need all 8 essential amino acids. So you must combine rice with beans to get a complete protein. But in her 10th year revised edition, she retracted that and said, I'm sorry, I was so wrong. You get all 8 essential amino acids from rice only or beans only. It's just good to have the variety, right? But you don't have to combine them to get a complete protein. What do you have to say about that? Because I know you personally interviewed Frances Moore LePay when she was getting all kinds of attention, supposedly giving us good advice about combining plant foods.
Yeah, Frances Moore LePay made some very positive contributions. But one of the things that she did that was negative, and as you mentioned, she apologized for it, was she convinced people that plant foods were incomplete and that you had to mix and match. And that means you have to be a dietitian or carry around a dietetic handbook to avoid something due to protein deficiency, which has never been described. I think unless you want to go to the trouble that you and I have gone through, Nick, and that is to look at the basic research, and I've reviewed that in several of the publications that I've written. Unless you want to go through that trouble, you need to come to the conclusion that there's no such thing as protein deficiency. Why? Because you've never seen it. You've never seen protein or amino acid deficiency. No friends have it. No offspring have it. No parents have it. Nobody has it.
Based on blood lab work, the protein levels remain just as good on a plant-based or better than they do on an animal-based diet. You don't see it. You brought up the best fact that in those people who starved, I think it was Ireland, and they went without food because it was a cause. And the people who died did not die of protein deficiency. They died of fat deficiency.
Right. Yeah. As I mentioned, and again, have faith or do the research yourself. You know, that's your choice. I've done the research. I put it together in a lecture that Nick has referred to on a few occasions. I just put it up on the internet on YouTube. You can look it up, McDougall and protein. It'll get you there pretty quickly. I will go over a lot of the research for you. And in the books that I've written, I go over the research. Otherwise, believe it. You have never seen protein or amino acid deficiency. You've seen problems due to excess protein, like kidney stones, osteoporosis, kidney damage, liver damage. And the foods they're associated with, when I say protein, you say meat. And maybe you say eggs. And maybe you say cheese. But that's the category of foods you're thinking of. So anything high protein is going to be high animal food. And that's really the destructive part of the diet. You don't have to go into any more details. Animal foods are food poisons for the human being. Yes, we're tough. Yes, we can tolerate 2 packs of cigarettes a day. Yes, we can live on a half a bottle of whiskey a day. Yes, we can live on hot dogs wrapped in bacon. The body's tough. But these are food poisons as results in a slow death, breast cancer, colon cancer, prostate cancer, heart disease, strokes, diabetes, kidney. It's ubiquitous. It affects over 80% of the people living in developed countries, Nick. You know, what troubles me, and I know it troubles you, and AJ deals with it every day with her people on her class, is why can't you see this? It's so obvious. People don't want to see it. I think that's the problem, is they're so attached, as I used to be, to their pepperoni pizza, to their glazed hams, you know, to their cheese sandwiches. They're so attached that somehow they don't think they can live without their favorite foods. I've had to come to the conclusion that what people eat is more personal, brings up more defensive reactions than does the discussion of religion and or politics. I can talk to people about religion or politics. Well, I really can't.
Or sex.
I don't talk to them about their food.